submitted. We thank counsel for their arguments, and we'll proceed to the next case on the calendar, Arciga versus Frauenheim. All right, counsel have 15 minutes aside, and Mr. Eldridge, whenever you're ready.
Good morning, Your Honors. David Andrew Eldridge, Deputy Attorney General for Respondent, who is the appellant in this case. This case, too, begins with a lack of Supreme Court precedent that is necessary for the writ to have been granted.
So, counsel, I apologize for interrupting you so early, but I have a preliminary question, and I'm going to ask your friend this as well. The Superior Court docket sheet, maybe that's not what it's called, but it says that there was an oral ruling by the trial court judge in the second trial, which says that the conviction is conditionally vacated.
The prior one, yes.
What does that mean?
Well, one thing, it means it's not unconditionally vacated.
Well, but what does it mean? What does it mean that the conviction is conditionally vacated? Or tell me what the state of California's view is, or opinion is, as to what that means.
The argument, the basis, the argument was made to the trial judge. I was in contact with the DA, was that do not set it aside because do not unconditionally vacate it, because if we prevail in the Ninth Circuit, we want the court to be able to reinstate it.
Okay, so that's what the argument was, but you can't cite any law, California law, that says that that's a term of art of some sort.
Well, the statute cited Code Civil Procedure 187 begins where there is a lack of statutes. That's the court must decide what procedures to use when there is no statutory or constitutional direction. So given that this was only done in order to allow the new trial to take place, but when the court says specifically unconditionally, okay. Conditionally.
Do you have any California case law or procedural law that says, in a circumstance like this, if we were to agree with you on the merits and reverse the district court, is there any California precedent law or anything that would say the second trial becomes a nullity and we reinstate the first conviction, notwithstanding the fact that jeopardy attached in the second trial and went to a verdict? Is there anything you can cite us to?
I have Calderon v. Moore, which says that even after a trial has begun, a reverse of a writ grant would obviate the need for it. So it can't be that commencing the trial is enough to make it moot. So if commencing it is enough to make it moot, why would...
But is there any California law that says this can happen in California?
I'm not aware of... I don't have a case in which this has actually happened.
Would it make any difference to your position if at the second trial the petitioner had been acquitted?
That would get more difficult to analyze.
Why?
Because the word thorny comes up. You have constitutional questions of whether or not you would be able to impose the prior one once a second jury has acquitted him.
What my sort of doctrinal philosophical problem is, I mean, I agree with the statement you just made, but I have trouble seeing why it would make any difference depending on what the result was. That why would the fact that there was an acquittal rather than a conviction make it more difficult to reinstate the first verdict, because double jeopardy, it doesn't matter what the result is, really. It matters that you are theoretically being twice put in jeopardy.
Well, being placed in jeopardy twice was the prior jeopardy has already occurred. The prior conviction already occurred. So double jeopardy is a bar on the second one. So double jeopardy really doesn't make any sense to assert here because.
And then why would it make a difference? Why would it make a difference were he hypothetically acquitted at the second trial?
I think a court would hesitate more just because there's a certain sense of something when there's an acquittal. But I'm not sure at all that he couldn't. And indeed, my argument would be that you still can because the second one, the person already was convicted after a proper trial, and the fact that he later got something he wasn't entitled to isn't much different than an appellate court reversing and then taking it up on review and the California Supreme Court saying you shouldn't have reversed it and undoing the reversal. So
I want to go back to one of the facts or the from the court docket. And again, I don't know what the term used. I have a printout from the Superior Court docket, and it reflects a defense motion on February 8 to vacate the previous sentence. And it was an oral motion, and the record says motion denied. And then there's something apparently currently pending, a notice of written motion filed on March 3rd by the defense to vacate the prior record of conviction, and that apparently is pending, scheduled for hearing next week. I haven't seen anything that reflects the conditional vacating. And so what exactly happened there?
The motion for judicial notice that we did not oppose and this court granted, so docket entry 16.
Let's see here.
The final page.
And that's what I was quoting from Judge Clifton.
And that was on... That was before the thing you just cited, which I don't believe was placed before this court.
Yeah, I was trying to figure how the sequence went. So I wound up checking the court record just to see what was happening when. And it may have been I didn't go back far enough early in time.
I am aware of the filing you just referenced. The DA sent me a copy, which I haven't had a chance to look at. And their effort is to make sure that you can't, but it's just a motion and, the DA is expected to oppose it and point out that the court's authority is as broad.
It can make a substantial difference because the case law in this field is skimpy. I could appreciate your difficulty in responding to Judge Bennett's question because there just isn't much out there to speak to. There is a Seventh Circuit case that seems to speak to this, the Brown case, but that turns on the fact that the court in, I guess, Indiana had vacated the previous conviction, and it looks like the only thing we have to deal with is this conditional setting aside to permit the second trial to go through, but it still hasn't been resolved by the Superior Court, let alone by the appellate courts of California, what the impact of all of this is. So you can't find a case one way, and you can't find a case the other way, as best I can figure out.
That's correct. Although the cases on 187 are quite broad, and they note that the court can do whatever is necessary to make sure no rights are lost. So it wouldn't be that there'd be a statute necessarily, and it's not really surprising that there wouldn't be much case law on it because there aren't a staggering number of writ grants that in which this would arise. But the difficulty that you... I'm sorry, I forgot to ask him to reserve time.
So, counsel, I interrupted your Batson argument, and I'm going to give you enough time to make a Batson argument, and we'll still give you some rebuttal time.
I'll go right back to this first. I tried to give you the best answer I could, but I have to point out it is not our burden to show that this case is not moot in the ordinary sense. It is the defendant's petitioner's burden to show that there is no relief available. So if there is a question this court has as to whether or not this would have the effect of enabling the state court to do something to reinstate the prior judgment, this court proceeds as though it does, because there is a heavy burden to prove mootness, not a burden to disprove it.
Well, my guess is that we'll be asking your friend similar questions.
In light of the lack of real response to the Batson arguments, I don't have an affirmative thing I want to say. I'm really, I could
respond to what the district court's order said. And I got to tell you that I look at what happened here. It's not unlike Johnson versus California in the sense that the trial court and the appellate courts of California recited what was supposed to happen, but then behaved in a way that the Supreme Court said, that's not what Batson instructs us.
Okay.
And so I'm not sure the same problem doesn't exist here, because in this case, the trial court short-circuited the process by declaring there had been no prima facie case shown, which is step one. And then the Court of Appeals went and said, well, under our law, we're supposed to examine to see if the prosecutor might have had legitimate reasons. And we imagine these reasons could exist, so we're going to say it's okay. The problem is that's not a step one evaluation.
That's a step three
evaluation after a step two where the prosecutor is called upon to give actual reasons, and none of that happened here.
That's not true, Your Honor. Batson or Johnson do not in any way say an appellate court is supposed to try to resolve step one.
You're splitting up the question. It's not really the question before us. We're concerned with the end result. Is the end result compliant with Batson?
Okay.
And you've tried to subdivide an issue that says all we're talking about here is the appellate standard of review.
Yes.
I'm less concerned with the articulated standard of review than what actually happens when the court goes to apply that standard. Because it does not appear to constitute a review of the district court's decision at step one that there was no prima facie case.
Well, they're not required to review it at all, Your Honor. There is no right
there,
to...
There's no... But that means we go back to the trial court's articulation.
And if
that's not something you're going to try to defend.
But, Your Honor, when you say you cut it short at step one, Batson explicitly says you can cut it short at step one if you don't make the showing. So
Did the Court of Appeal conclude that defendant, in that context, that defendant had not made a prima facie case? Or did the Court of Appeal go on to the subsequent steps of Batson and say there might have been legitimate reasons for the prosecutor to object?
The Court of Appeal, you're actually misstating it.
Did the Court of Appeal do?
The Court of Appeal said,
I'm putting to you.
You do not prove that the trial court failed at step one if the record has some tendency to show reasons that the prosecution would. Not because we can be sure ourselves that the prosecution didn't make a step one, that the defendant didn't make a step one showing, but because, just as this court in Tolbert v. Page has acknowledged, you can't realistically determine or second guess the trial judge.
Counsel, the California's argument here is that even if there was the required prima facie showing because of the number of people with Hispanic surnames on which the prosecutor used his peremptories, even though if it were doing a straight step one analysis, that would meet it, that Batson is satisfied by someone, either the trial court or the appellate court, making a factual finding that in the absence of the prosecutor offering any justification for his or her strikes, there was some evidence in the record which could have justified those strikes other than racial bias. So is it California's position that the combination of those two things satisfies Batson, regardless of who makes the finding?
No. Batson requires the trial judge to make that finding. There are a stream of cases, and what happens when the trial judge didn't have the right finding in mind, and therefore courts have tried to fix it.
But what we have here, as I understand it, is a large number of jurors in the voir dire array were struck who had Spanish surnames. And the trial court said there is evidence in the record that might have justified the prosecutor's strikes on non-racial reasons, so I'm not going to even make the prosecutor state their reasons.
No.
That's not what happened?
No, that is not what happened. First of all, you don't have the actual Batson arguments in front of you. That was done off the record.
No, but I have the trial court's findings.
It's summary, and its summary isn't that because there are reasons that could have existed, I find no prima facie case. He says, I took notes of each of them, and I don't find the pattern that apparently was argued outside, and you simply didn't make a showing. I have ruled the point there's no prima facie case of exclusion, and I note your statement that there are 15 jurors excused, a significant number of which barring Hispanic surnames. But I did my best to keep track and keep notes. Based on those answers, it does appear that none, that there wasn't a pattern of discrimination based on racial makeup alone, and there is no showing that, and I won't even ask people to make a response, which exactly is what Batson doesn't require, is statements until you have succeeded at step one, no statements are required. So there's nothing suspicious, there's nothing odd or wrong about failing to ask.
Unless we were to find that whatever the standard of review was, even if we were deferentially reviewing those factual findings by the trial court, that based on the actual voir dire transcript, that was clearly in error.
Well, you would have to find that it is an unreasonable determination of fact.
Yes.
And
assuming it's entitled to deference, we would have to find that.
An unreasonable determination of fact based on the evidence that was presented. And you don't have all the evidence that was presented. You don't know what the gestures were. You don't know what the expressions were. This is exactly
whose responsibility is that?
The person with the burden of proof.
Well, but the Supreme Court made a point of saying we don't want to speculate here. And that's why the Supreme Court has said the burden at step one is low because we want to get the prosecutor to give the actual reasons and then have a record to evaluate.
Well,
and what happened here is the trial court decided to apply what it thought was the step one standard prima facie, but applied a standard that seems to be somewhat higher than the Supreme Court required. And then, and this is what I'm trying to get to, I look at the Court of Appeal decision, which recognizes that the trial court's decision was prima facie, step one. But then the court goes on to discuss the factors that are supposed to be considered at steps two and three.
Your Honor,
and where in the Court of Appeal is there a discussion that explains why the trial court's decision at step one is appropriate?
Well, when the California Court of Appeal says that we affirm a step one ruling, if these things are shown, it is saying this is a standard by which the only thing we can do in determining at step one whether it was proper, because we don't have the record that the trial judge had. They're not saying, for example, that we can realistically question the trial judge, because there are all these things that we'll never know. And the burden, the defendant has the ability to make more of a record at step one if he wishes. He can ask.
Well, what we do have, though, is the undisputed fact that no one ever asked the prosecutor for their reasons. We know that.
That's correct. And that's not supposed to happen at step one, Your Honor. At step one is you're not supposed to question unless you've made the prima facie case at step one. When you keep saying, for example, the court thought you were supposed to say prima facie at step one, that is the standard at step one. That is what Batson says. You don't get to ask the prosecution to reveal their reasons until you've made a plausible showing at step one.
So tell me how that decision can be affirmed based not on a review of, for example, the evidence we have in front of us about the number of Spanish surnamed members of the panel and so forth, but instead by speculating as to what reasons the prosecutor might have had for exercising challenges, which under the Batson formula is supposed to come later. Under the formula you're talking about is still included in this prima facie showing at step one. But that's what the Court of Appeal talked about.
Well, when you say these things are And you keep implying that they are only relevant at step
that relevant at step one?
If it's not relevant only at step three or step two, then it is also relevant at step one. And I remind you that the court's task is determined from all of the evidence presented, which means all the evidence in the show, what might be an obvious reason.
You haven't disputed the evidence and the conclusion of the district court based on the number of Spanish surname members of the panel and the exercise of challenges. You haven't directly challenged the district court's conclusion that that makes a prima facie showing of discrimination, which should have required the trial court to have gone further.
I have argued that the California, the Court of Appeals, the state district trial court made a fact finding, and it has not, and the district judge got around that by saying, well, the appellate court made the wrong ruling. And I've also argued that the lower court, the trial judge's ruling would stand up even in a pre-EPA case, because in a pre-EPA case, all this court did was look and see whether or not there was a reason that would have supported it.
All right.
And affirmed.
Thank you.
Affirming a step one ruling.
Thank you, counsel. We'll give you some time for a rebuttal.
May it please the court, David Porter from the Federal Defender's Office in Sacramento. I represent Mario Arciga, who is the appellee and the petitioner in this case. I'd like to address just Judge Bennett's question that started off the argument about California law. My learned colleague concedes that there is no California law addressing this particular point about what is a conditional vacatur. Conditionally vacating the judgment. And I suggest to you that it's not completely, that it's probably irrelevant in light of federal law that addresses the federal jurisdictional question. The judgment was in effect vacated by the district court's judgment. And once the jury was impaneled in the state court, in the Fresno Superior Court, that judgment no longer exists.
Well, but it's just, you know, that may be the case, but I don't see why, for example, California couldn't have a rule that said, in this circumstance where the federal courts say retry or release, and then we have a second trial, at which there's a conviction, and then the Court of Appeals says the district court got it wrong. I don't understand why California couldn't have a rule that says we go back to the first determination. I have no idea whether they have such a rule or not, but explain to me why they couldn't have such a rule.
Well, I think that the concession is that there is no such rule.
Well, the concession was they don't know.
They don't know.
And you're not asserting that there's a clear rule to the contrary. And in fact, the argument's been made, the burden's on your client here. So we got a vacuum.
Well, what
would you point us to?
No, I would point to the double jeopardy clause and just try and spin that out.
Because double jeopardy speaks to what happens later. None of the cases you cited in your papers to us, and I guess we've made you file lots of papers, none of them seem to speak to this situation.
Right, that is true. And I think your remarks earlier were exactly correct, that this is not the usual case. The usual case is where a habeas petition becomes moot because during the pendency of the federal proceedings, the petitioner dies, or the petitioner is released from custody or is paroled.
Or in the Seventh Circuit case where the Seventh Circuit emphasized that it's vacated, it's gone, habeas jurisdiction is jurisdiction over the body, not the conviction. And since it is absolutely gone under, if it's Indiana law, then, you know, we have nothing here. But
yes. But
until I know what conditionally vacated means, I have difficulty deciding if the Seventh Circuit case is on point.
There is that factual distinction, Your Honor, that in that case, the state court did what is logically, I think, compelled to do, to vacate the earlier conviction so that the person can go to trial.
Although that wasn't what the district court's order was. It was release or retry.
Right.
It didn't say vacate.
Well, because it can't.
Right.
Right? So,
I mean, I look at the Seventh Circuit decision in Brown.
Yes.
And it deals with subsequent arguments after it's rested its decision on the point that the Indiana state conviction had been released. And then it says it's clear, and they cite three Supreme Court cases after discussing them, that compliance with a federal court's writ of habeas corpus with respect to the petitioner's sentence or custody does not render the complying state's appeal of that writ moot. And goes on to say, of course, none of those cases dealt with what we have here, a vacature of the underlying conviction. And so we don't have a, at least clearly established vacature of the underlying conviction. And the Seventh Circuit decision, one of the few that speaks, says that, well, the Supreme Court's decisions haven't said that it makes the appeal of the habeas order moot. So why is it that we should treat it as moot if there hasn't been a clear vacature under California law?
Because I think if we play that out, that scenario out, if what happened was this court ruled in the state's favor, I have a very difficult time believing that the state trial judge would then say, oh, well, the Ninth Circuit has reversed the district court's judgment. We're going to go back, in the absence of state law on this, we're going to vacate the jury's verdict in this case.
And as a result, they can't appeal me. This case never sees the light of day again. I'm not sure a trial judge would be all that broken up if the case just goes away.
Well, I think that...
I said that facetiously, but it's also serious because it could be well argued, has been argued, that this case isn't moot because whatever might happen in the pending case goes away. You wouldn't have to have a sentencing. You wouldn't have to have the appeals that follow from the conviction and whatever sentencing. Trial number two turns out to be unnecessary because trial number one supports a valid conviction and sentence. What's wrong with that?
I don't think that there's, as we've discussed, I don't think there's any law directly on point on that. But I think that when you look at the situation in the absence of California law and the existence of the double jeopardy clause and the...
Where's the double jeopardy problem? Because the first trial, usually double jeopardy concern is you start, stop, and then convict him the second time. Here, he was convicted the first time. It's not going to get, presumably, the whole reason he's pursued the habeas and the retrials, he doesn't think it's going to get any worse. And my problem here is that, as suggested by the Brown decision, to make the conclusion this case is moot strips the state of the ability to appeal an adverse habeas decision, because the reality is, as we've seen in this case, the time given to the state to commence a retrial is going to be too short for the ordinary appellate process. I mean, we're on an expedited schedule, but the retrial's already taken place. And so it seems to me the rule you're advocating for basically offers a one-way street. That is, the state will never have the opportunity to appeal an adverse district court decision with regard to habeas. And why should that be?
No, the state could have released him. The state could have dismissed the earlier judgment and proceeded on a new complaint or an indictment.
How does that give them what I just offered up, which is why can't they appeal the district court's decision?
They could. They could
but
appeal
they
the
couldn't
district
here
court.
Because you're telling me the case is moot and we can't review it rapidly enough.
No, the state could have...
You're saying they could have released him and just held off on retrying?
Yes, and held off, but not very long. They could reconvene a grand jury.
Or,
they
or
could
they,
issue an information.
Or they could have released him while this appeal went forward, but your client was convicted of very serious rape charges. So the option of just releasing him to comply with the order while the appeal went forward may not have been a very feasible or attractive alternative.
But that was only one alternative. The county of Fresno, the district's attorney office, could have issued an information or had an indictment issued against the defendant, against Mr. Arciga, and proceeded on that.
Before the conviction was vacated?
That would have been vacating the conviction.
But so there would be nothing to defend from the first habeas grant. I mean, that seems to be to epitomize the problem I've identified, which is that for the county to proceed, as you just described, means that first conviction's gone away completely. We're in the Brown situation. So even if the state were right in the arguments they've brought, we couldn't do anything about it because the first conviction's been vacated. So brings me back to the problem I posed. It seems to me the route you're proposing for us strips the state of the ability to ever appeal a habeas grant. And how is it otherwise? And why should that be?
I don't think that's the case. And I think that in Calderon versus Moore, which the state has repeatedly misrepresented, the trial had not yet even begun in that case. And when this is the language from that decision. While the administrative machinery necessary for a new trial has been set in motion, that trial has not yet even begun, let alone reached a point where the court could no longer award any relief in the state's favor. Because a decision in the state's favor would release it from the burden of the new trial itself, the Court of Appeals is not prevented from granting any effectual relief whatever in the state's favor. The negative implication of that is this case. What? Not only has the trial begun, it has concluded in a verdict of guilty.
Counsel, walk us through what is going to happen in the second conviction. So I understand there's a resentencing that's been scheduled to occur in the next few weeks. Is that correct?
In 1 week, on March 14th.
Okay. So we have the first conviction that has been conditionally vacated, and you agree that there hasn't been an order by the trial court vacating the first conviction. There's only this language of a conditional vacature. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So what keeps the state from waiting to see what the sentence is in the second conviction? Who decides which conviction and which sentence will apply after this, if this court doesn't find that it lacks jurisdiction to hear this appeal and decides the merits of the appeal on the habeas claim? Who decides which conviction of Mr. Arciga will in fact apply if the state gets to choose? So the state, you're going to have a resentencing in a few weeks or in a week. There's a conviction that the state contends is still in effect, and that this court should decide the underlying claim.
Yes.
What happens then?
I think that it's up to this court. You said who decides. I think it's incumbent upon this court to decide its own jurisdiction. That's the court's sua sponte duty.
And what if we decide we do have jurisdiction? The case is not moot. We have jurisdiction to decide. And we, let's just say, reverse the lower court.
Yes. Then what would happen? I don't know. I mean, I really... I think we're in the same position that I had with the hypothetical earlier, is that I don't believe that the state trial judge there held a jury trial and will be willing to say that was all a nullity, that we're going to go back to this earlier judgment. I don't think that there's any procedural mechanism for it. I don't think it's logically consistent and...
Could be an interesting appeal for the California Court of Appeal and Supreme Court to figure out, but that's why we all get paid so much.
Yes.
Okay, why don't you take a few minutes, and we'll give you some extra time to get to the Batson argument.
Okay, thank you, Your Honor. So I'd like to, on the issue of mootness, I'd just like to point out the Supreme Court's decision in Alvarez versus Smith in 2009, because I think that that's what's happening here. The quote is, "A dispute solely about the meaning of the law, abstracted from any concrete, actual, or threatened harm, falls outside the scope of the constitutional words."
Well, if you want to go back and talk about mootness rather than Batson, we can, but that doesn't speak to me, because I've just hypothesized that if I don't know that the case is moot, because it could affect what happens in state court hereafter, and that's what we've been talking about. So. Well, I mean, if you want to use your time on mootness, go ahead. But sometime I'd hope you talk about Batson.
Okay, I will discuss Batson, Your Honor, Judge Clifton. I agree with your earlier comments to my learned colleague that this
is... That's why I wanted you to talk about Batson.
Exactly,
you know?
Like Johnson, that looked at what the court did, not what the court necessarily said. It's more important what the court did. And we have numerous cases from the Supreme Court saying we want the actual reasons why the prosecutor used peremptory challenges against racial minorities. That's what we're aiming for here. And that's what the state court failed to do in this case. It imagined reasons, and that violates clearly established federal laws determined by the Supreme Court of the United States. They've said in Miller L, the standard is demanding but not insatiable. And in this case, I think there was a compelling textbook example of a violation of Batson. The district court, the very experienced district court who sat for 18 years as a magistrate judge and ruled on habeas cases, applied the ADPA correctly in this case, and we ask that the court affirm the judgment of the district court.
All right. We'll put 2 minutes on the clock for rebuttal. And then for counsel in the courtroom, when we're done with this case, we're going to take a 10-minute recess before we get to the final two cases on the argument calendar.
I just want to emphasize that nothing in Johnson or in Batson says that in every case we need to know what the actual reasons were. If so, there wouldn't be a bother with step one in the first place. In step one, there's a threshold showing that it's to be made before the prosecutor has to disclose those reasons. So it is a prima facie case that has to be made, and it's the defendant's burden to show it, and he has to do it without being able to question the prosecutor. The prosecutor's statements only become in at step two, and you're not always supposed to reach step two. He has to make a plausible showing on his own first, and all the evidence will be considered. And as this court in Tolbert v. Page has recognized, so much of that evidence will be simply unavailable to a later court. And so the idea that a later court, that their task is to somehow make the step one ruling themselves to say, well, really, was there an inference, is incorrect. That is something that really is the duty of the trial judge. And just as a later court could decide not to review the question at all, they could say, look, all we can do is say, is there some evidence? Because we can't really effectively review the question. So given that it's your task to disprove what the trial judge did was right, your task is almost always really impossible. But what we can do is look and see at least if there's some evidence, which is not really different, for example, when a parole decision is made, where a later court doesn't look at it and say, oh, no, we're going to decide whether or not you really should have been granted parole. All they do is say, well, there's some evidence supporting it. And that's all we can give you, because the real person enforcing the rule is at the lower level. Thank you, Your Honor.
All right. Thank you. We thank counsel for their argument. The case just argued will be submitted and will be in recess for 10 minutes.
All right.